The death of Bob Marley, reggae's only superstar, saw him given a state funeral in Jamaica in 1981. British roots bands that had once built themselves in Marley's image now found they were losing the support of their record companies and their audience.
These bands, Aswad, Mutumbi, Steel Pulse, had gone slower reggae and a bit more political. And the fun had gone out of reggae for a lot of those bands. It was a serious music now.
But the BBC playlists mostly remained a no-go area for reggae artists.
It's the Brotherhood of Flowerpots, that's it.
The industry still did not gravitate or cotton on to reggae music in its proper context. They still, you know, music still was not played on the airwaves, still wasn't publicised in newspapers. You know, interviews were still pretty much secluded to, you know, the black community papers.
I can remember record company individuals saying to me, look, Michael, the audience likes to buy itself. And I was going, what do you mean? You don't look like the audience. Bands like UB40, we saw as cashing in and all that hard work that we'd done to bring British reggae to a point where we could exploit it, only to be superseded by what we thought at the time was a more pastel, a weaker version, a commercial version of what we were doing.
There are some bands that think, you know, white guys shouldn't be playing reggae and that we've stolen their music, you know. But they're as English as we are, you know.
As the 80s unfolded, reggae moved away from its earlier militancy. UB40 now did an about turn and paid tribute to the softer classic hits of the early 70s that had inspired them to play reggae in the first place.
Labour of Love, which was the album that we'd wanted to do from the beginning, but everybody in the industry had gone, you can't do that, you mustn't do that, it'll be commercial suicide. And of course, as is usually the case, the opposite turned out to be the truth. It turned out to be another stroke of accidental genius. So before
it happened again, there was a more romantic British reggae evolving in the black community too. For dressing up, for feeling good, for a fun night out. They called it Lover's Rock.
Well, the way I understand Lover's Rock is more, is similar to Rocksteady, but it's English style. You know, it's laid back. You know, it's a bit, the lyrics are a bit more soppy. I mean, but that's it, really. But people love it, you know, because it's love songs with a difference. Cause if I keep on seeing you, baby, it's gonna make
me feel so blue. Well, Lover's Rock is one of the British created vibes in reggae music. You can be a revolutionary, you can be a soldier, but a soldier needs to come home to the family. A soldier needs love the same way.
It was the time to dance with your girl, whereas, like, when you listen to the Roots stuff, you know, you was chanting down Babylon, basically, on your own, you know, you was dancing on your own. Whereas with Lover's Rock, it was where you found yourself a girl to hold close and dance to, you know.
And you dressed up to make an impression. Right, and if you knew someone who sang that tune, oh, you were famous. You know, it was a whole, it's a lifestyle. It was a lifestyle, just like the Rasta and the Roots and Culture was a lifestyle.
Lover's Rock is the British sound. Lover's Rock is the British sound of reggae. from the days when people said you cannot make reggae in London. You have to go to Jamaica to get the feel. In England, artists were the producers.
British-based musicians were honing their musical and business skills.
In our case, we paid our own studio, right? We didn't have some executive. That's why we fell out with Trojan. Trojan wanted us to do cover versions of songs. So a pop song would come out and go, that's it, that's your next assignment. Reggae version of that, please, thank you. And then someone else would cop all the publishing. You know, we wanted to write and produce our own material, and it came out that way.
Though Lovers Rock was mostly sung by women for a female audience, the production was still handled by men.
You know, all the producers were male.
I dared to have an opinion.
Well,
which I did often.
Well, yeah,
and I was, fall out of favour very quickly to have an opinion.
Yeah.
And I did often find that I'd have to filter my opinion through a male to have it realised. It was about the track, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was about the track. And by the time you got to the vocals, it was like near the ending of the session, and then you'd have the producer. Time is money. And it's like they don't, you know, I want to get everything perfect, but there's never enough time to get everything perfect. And studio time used to cost so much money back in the day. So, you know, you sing a harmony, you think, well, that's not right, I need to do it again.
No,
it's like,
no, you wouldn't have time is money. My first track, the first record that came out was a demo. I just went in there to try it out. And I'm thinking, oh, that sounds familiar. And I came down and I thought, that's me, that's my song. And it was on the radio.
The next day.
And I hadn't even had a chance to go back and review it and make sure it was in tune. I was just sketching it. I think for you, I mean, because Janet came before me, I was inspired by Janet, so I remembered seeing Janet do Silly Games on Top of the Pops and thinking, oh, that's fantastic, I could do that.
Rare for black British reggae artists to appear on Top of the Pops. Some things hadn't changed in a decade.
When I recorded Silly Games, again, Silly Games, it was recorded in the same way that Carol and I spoke about, in that you go into the studio, you do a tune, you don't know what's going to happen. It's not, you know, you just go in there, and it was played by the sound systems for a while. And it circulated in the community for about 6 months before it actually got into the British charts.
We didn't even know how many albums or how many singles we'd actually sold. We didn't know how many hearts we'd actually touched.
Lovers Rock suffered from reggae's old problems. It was a cottage industry, dependent on the sound systems for distribution, with little or no support from the mainstream pop record business.
The effect of reggae music as becoming pop music in the 80s didn't really affect me, because I wasn't really invited into that world. That was a record company push. That was like Virgin and EMI and the rest of them. They weren't really interested in looking at black talent who had been involved in reggae industry. We weren't really invited to that party.
Lovers Rock, in a funny sort of way, it was kind of reggae music that didn't frighten white people. Safe to say, isn't it? It's like, it was kind of, oh, this is nice, you know, I can dance to this, you know.
Georgie's debt to Lovers Rock was obvious in Culture Club's first big hit. But the tabloid critics remain sceptical of Georgie's dread credentials.
White people have always seemed to have a problem with me doing reggae, not black people. You know, black people say it's a nice tune, you can sing reggae good. I always get complimented. White people seem to have a problem with it. Like, I remember the first review that we ever got for Do You Really Want to Hurt Me? They said it was fourth division Kathy Kirby watered down reggae. The only thing the Culture Club got going for them is the hideously unphotogenic Boy George. Ignore the eyebrow sleeve. I still remember it word for word. You've been talking about believing. If it's true, you do not know. Do You Really Want to Hurt Me was actually written over the B-side of a quite famous reggae record. I remember the sort of turning it over and playing the kind of dub version and coming up with a kind of melody idea, and then Mikey coming up with that brilliant bass line, you know, which is one of the most... The reggae thing crept into a lot of what we did, you know, as a band, you know. We were a multicultural band. It was a big thing for us, you know. But I loved what we became. It was much more fun, much more exciting, you know, kind of mixing genres around and just sort of throwing them into a big pot and seeing what came out, you know.
The new wave British bands adopted their image for videos designed for teenage MTV audiences. The Police dyed their hair blonde and took reggae into the rock video stratosphere.
We were wearing the flag of convenience. We were wearing the uniform du jour. We had the haircut of the day, critical. We could be together, walking on the... Well, every band struggles to get an audience, a bigger an audience and bigger and bigger and bigger and more and more and more. And at no time, I don't think, is there ever a calculation of, well, am I now, is this too much? Have I taken this too far? No, let's take it further.
The one black band that did briefly go global was Musical Youth. Five school kids from Birmingham who turned an old reggae song about smoking ganja into a homily to the cooking pot. Pass the Dutchie pan the left hand side. Pass the Dutchie pan the left hand side. It a go bun. Give me the music, make me jump and run. It a go done.
Musical Youth getting to number one with Pass the Dutchie was, well, it was important to me because I made the video. You've got to understand, this video was shown on Blue Peter, like, one afternoon, and the next day it went to number one. It was actually on the national news, and then went to number one in 18 countries around the world. Apparently, that was actually the first all-black video on MTV.
Musical Youth reflected two cultures. The first was the Jamaican homeland of their parents. The second was their British upbringing and schooling. Like the music itself, the twin cultures could now flourish side by side.
11-10-9-8-7-6-5-4-3-2-1 It's I, smiley culture with the mic in my hand. Me come to teach you right, not the wrong end of the cockney translation. Cockney's not a language, it is only a slang. And was originated, yeah, so in England. The first place it was used was over East London. It was respect for the different style pronunciation.
It's two different cultures, and I feel that, you know what I mean, respect's due to both, because I know both, so I thought that I'd do something to kind of complement that. It's, again, looking at what you've got around you and taking it and making it into a lyrical thing, you know what I mean?
Say Cockney fire shoot, ah, we bust one. Say Cockney tight tea leaf, we just a six man. You know them have wedge while we have con. Say Cockney tight big first man done, we just a one.
Whatever the lyric was, it was about the lyric, and the whole story worked as a story, as opposed to just having a verse here and a little thing chorus. And, you know, I think now it's more and more coming that way, but I think we were really ahead of our time.
Rupin and Chopper reach on Mr. Cockney called Tama. Say Cockney say outbuilt with the dirty Babylon.
Great. Not so much reggae, but the music is definitely reggae influenced, you know.
Smiley Culture had learnt his style of video MCing with the Saxon sound system, which had been touring the UK since the mid-70s. He travelled with Saxon colleagues like Tipper Irie.
He used to just, you know, take styles from each other, and but the main thing is that we defeat the other sound that's stringed up over there.
No. Me humble, me conscious, you know me righteous. You want me autograph, please wait, don't rush. Tipper Irie is life and London blood. But it's good to have the feeling you're the best.
It's good to have the feeling you're the best. It's really a lyric that I wrote about the sound system, Saxon.
Yes, it's good to have the feeling you're the best. Cause I control the north, south, east and west. In London and Birmingham, I have to confess.
But always original. Always, you know, always our own. We wouldn't follow what they were doing in Jamaica.
I think sometimes the understated backbone of British black music is the sound system. It is reggae. And we've all evolved out of that collective experience of reggae in different ways. It has spawned many subgenres and many interpretations of it. One of the best examples of that was Soul to Soul.
Reggae was being marketed for the 80s, packaged to appeal to everyone, here and in the USA.
Our idea was based on the sound system. We came up with an idea of a happy face, a thumping bass for a loving race. One of our ideas was obviously to take the whole idea of the dread uptown. So we were kind of creating a different style, a new myth, as it were. And the whole effect of us trying to put all of these things into this incredible melting pot, which allowed us to be inclusive.
With the cultures blending, it's merging more. I think that people, it's hard, like I said, to distinguish between colour as much anymore. Even though people want to kind of keep it black and white, I think you can't do that. I think that it's just not going to happen anymore. It's really becoming people as opposed to just colour.
In the 30 years since reggae first arrived here, it had propelled and reflected many changes in our music and society. And though reggae, as we knew it, had passed away, its musical descendants survive and flourish.
Thank you. Its roots were from Jamaica and its beats united our youth.
It was our music. It was something that we said this was ours.
Desmond Dekker, Return of the Django. That was the start of the love affair.
The lyrics and sentiment was to do with a rebel stance, which we all associated with.
We completely plundered reggae without remorse.
We never thought English people had so much oomph.
Celebrate the rebel sounds that revolutionised Britain. Reggae season continues Sunday at 9 on BBC4.